What brings you to Fairbury, and are you going around and touring a bunch of towns across the state? I mean, is this part of a tour, and what is it about?
Well, we get out pretty often across the state, and you feel like it's very important to engage with not only students and parents and alums of the university, but civic leaders and business leaders and government officials across the state. So during the summer, we tend to have an opportunity to do a little more of that than during the school year. So we're visiting over 20 different communities during the summer across the state. So today I've had the opportunity to be in Beatrice and over at Geneva and now in Fairbury. And always it's very valuable to be able to hear people about the university and what they think of what's happening at the university and its impact, as well as kind of tell the story of the university too.
Okay, sounds good. Now, you became a chancellor in 2016. Is this your third summer doing this type of tour, if you will?
Well, I've done it a lot historically over time. As chancellor, this is kind of my second summer doing it.
Okay.
But I was at the university for a period of years before that, from 2010 to 2016. I served as the vice chancellor of the university. And so I had responsibility for what we call the statewide campus, the agriculture programs and natural resource programs across the state. And we have extension and research centers all over the state of Nebraska. Mm-hmm. So I've had the opportunity to get to know the state very well during that time period and spend a lot of time out in the state. But as chancellor, this is, my second full year of having the opportunity to be out in the state in this role.
Okay. So I guess before we dive into a few topics, have you been out to Fairbury before?
I've been through Fairbury many times.
Okay.
Yeah, my wife actually grew up in Clay County, and so we know the southern tier of the state pretty well. And but I don't think I've actually ever been here for an event before or had an opportunity to engage with people in the community. So this is it's a great opportunity.
Well, you do plan to go check out the Jefferson County Fair here, right?
Yeah.
Before you leave out of town.
Yeah, we'll have a chance to be over and visit with people at the fair this evening, and opportunity to visit not only with 4-H youth through extension there, but also with our extension professionals and a lot of other folks there as well.
Okay. One of our reporters, or I should say editors, was out at the Cattleman's Ball. And
sure.
He said he saw you and Bill Moose out there as
sure.
well. And I wanted to ask, was that your first time at an event, the Cattleman's Ball event?
Or? Oh, no.
No, you've been
not at all.
Those?
No,
okay.
In fact, I think I've been to, maybe six or seven of the Cattleman's Balls over the years. My wife and I actually were a co-host of the Cattleman's Ball in Lincoln, the Lincoln area, just south of Lincoln at Princeton 2 years ago.
Okay.
And have been very involved in trying to help support the calls for the Cattleman's Ball to raise money for cancer research at UNMC. And so it was kind of a neat opportunity to be there this year and to get a chance to introduce Bill Moose and his wife Kendra to a lot of folks and have them have an opportunity to enjoy that event. And it also was in a town, a kind of neighborhood town of where my wife grew up. So it was a great opportunity to see a lot of folks up
what
there.
What town specifically is that?
She grew up in Clay County, near between Sutton and Harvard. So Hebron was Thayer Central. We kind of knew.
Okay.
Our kids grew up in Sutton, and we did a lot of competition against the kids at Thayer Central, too.
So that's obviously an area you guys like and probably visit every so often.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, cool deal. That's very good. So I guess diving into issues, I know your education, you got animal sciences and agriculture. It's kind of your wheelhouse. I saw you grew up on farm in Southwest Virginia.
Right.
And I guess when did you initially move out here?
I grew up in Virginia, as you said, in a background in agriculture, went to school in Virginia as an undergrad at Virginia Tech.
Mm-hmm.
Left there when I was 21 to go pursue graduate work at Colorado State, ended up here at Nebraska to do my doctoral work in the 1980s. So I got my PhD here at UNL. Mm-hmm. My research work was actually out at the U.S. Meat Animal Research Center at Clay Center. And then we actually moved back to Nebraska. My wife, as I said, is from here, and We moved back to Nebraska in 2003, and I had been working with the USDA and leading research programs for USDA, as well as US Mark was part of that in Clay Center, and then came back to the university in 2010. So I feel like I'm an adopted transplant fully in Nebraska.
So, yeah, maybe a home away from home, if you will.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, good deal.
I feel as much Nebraskan as I do Virginian.
Okay, all right. That's good, that's good. okay, so I guess a big topic is the budget cuts, but I guess the University of Wisconsin, they're trying to cut like 13 programs at Stevens Point location, and about... careers like liberal arts, social sciences, and then they are trying to do more career-oriented, you know, geared towards that. Is UNL kind of heading in that direction to where, you know, kids are getting degrees that actually translate to real-world jobs, or where are you guys
at with that? Well, I think UNL's always been that way.
Okay.
You know, we've always seen ourselves as an institution that has the end game in mind for students, so we've always been a very applied institution in that regard, in terms of workforce development and preparation. What you're referring to that's happening in Wisconsin at Stevens Point, Wisconsin is a state that has a system of university campuses around the state as part of the University of Wisconsin, have a whole series of campuses. Their counterpart to what we would be like would be the University of Wisconsin at Madison, co-member of the Big Ten with us. Those campuses that were set up in Wisconsin, over 10 of them in the state, were set up as career campuses originally. So they had, there was a campus that was set up for teacher education, a campus that was set up for vocational arts, a campus that was set up for engineering-related training. And some of what's happening there in that particular case is kind of a return. Those campuses had moved to be more general, and now they're kind of returning more to the roots in the Stevens Point case, as I understand it. So at UNL, our focus is, you know, we have a wide variety of majors for students across our 9 academic colleges that are very career-driven by default. So engineering, if you go to school as in the engineering college, you're going to be an engineer more than likely in one of a variety of fields. If you go in the College of Business, you're going to be an accountant, or you're going to be an actuarial scientist, or you're going into the finance world, or you're going into the banking world or the marketing world. If you go into the ag program, variety of 14 different opportunities and direction that you go career-wise. So it's architecture, law, I could go on and on.
Right.
So it's designed to be that way by default, where the end game is what we have in mind when the student comes there with their major.
Okay, very good. I guess gear it towards maybe rural Nebraska, agriculture is a big thing.
Yeah.
And is there any programs or events in the works right now currently that are kind of geared towards agriculture, rural communities, and helping out the farm economy across the state?
Well, absolutely. So my background, as you said, was in agriculture, and we historically have known we'll be 150 years old this coming year, and we're excited about having the opportunity to observe that anniversary. Our hallmark, one of our hallmark areas that we're known for around the world, is our strength in agriculture, natural resources, everything to do with the agricultural industry. So when people think of higher education and universities that have impacted the world of agriculture, that continue to impact the world of agriculture on an applied basis, a lot of the technologies that we use, a lot of the things that are improving agriculture, have been developed at the University of Nebraska. So water, food security, food science, agricultural economics, animal science, the livestock industry in particular, plant science and innovation around plant science, much of that has been developed at the University of Nebraska. We're very proud of that and continue to be a world leader in those areas. So every day we're impacting agriculture in Nebraska in very significant ways.
Okay, and I would say, what are your thoughts on the state of the agriculture I don't know, industry in the state of currently right now, state of Nebraska?
Agriculture is a cyclical industry. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Markets are very cyclical in nature. And, you know, unfortunately, we tend to be in a more challenging time in the crop markets and in the livestock markets. But, you know, that will cycle through. You know, we continue to see agriculture become more and more efficient. We continue to see those records continue to be broken, no matter which sector you're in, whether you're in the plant protein sector or the animal protein sector. It's amazing what we can do in agriculture now that we couldn't do even a decade ago. Mm-hmm. In terms of our productive ability. Yeah. The markets, you know, have to correct themselves.
Right.
So we happen to be in a period of time where we're correcting after we were in a period of time in the 5 years ago. The markets here were more robust than anybody could ever remember in their lifetime. Mm-hmm. So I'm hopeful that we'll see the markets turn here in the next couple of years back into much more favorable territory.
Okay. And when you took the chancellor job back in 2016, what kind of were your top priorities? And now a few years later, where you feel like you're at in progress?
There is tremendous momentum at the university. So when I came into this role 2 years ago, we had been experiencing significant momentum at the university no matter how you measured it, whether it was in student enrollment and the number of students that were coming to the university and graduating from the university and going out into the workforce. This year, this fall, we expect to have the fourth year in a row of record enrollment at the university in our 150-year history. It's a pretty cool thing. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, our highest enrollment had been in 1981. Now, 4 years ago, we broke that record, and in each year successively, we've broken it again. We expect to be up another several hundred students this mm-hmm. fall over our previous record. So very excited about that. Mm-hmm. Very excited to be seeing where that growth is, particularly in business, particularly in engineering, particularly in agriculture, you know, areas that are of high importance to us in the state. Mm-hmm. We're breaking our all-time research records at the university. This last year was the biggest year we've ever had in our history, over $300 million in research work done at the university. And like in this past year, we're on track to break that again this coming year. Very excited about that, where we're world leaders in water research, in ag research, in material sciences and nanosciences, world leader in physics, world leader in creative writing, world leader in early childhood education. I could go on down the list. So wonderful to see that happening in areas of research that matter to Nebraska, matter to us as the university that serves our state. Our extension programs continue to break records as well. We are a land-grant university, which means we serve the people of the state. And part of the way we serve people in the state is by translating what we do out to the public throughout the state of Nebraska, across all of our 93 counties. So our extension service, known as one of the best in the United States, continues to have that reputation, and we're very proud of what they're doing to translate the university's work out in communities across the state. Mm-hmm. A huge amount of building growth on our campus. You know, yeah. If you come to Lincoln, you see, you can't yeah. miss that the campus is changing yeah. physically.
New business school or addition?
The new business building that we opened a year ago. So mm-hmm. we'll have our second year of that going in this fall. $84 million new state-of-the-art facility for the College of Business, all privately fundraised, mm-hmm. Built by donors to the university and alums of the college. About to start two big new building projects in the next year and a half in our College of Engineering, a renovation of that complex on our campus. And in addition to that, new construction around our education college, in our College of Education and Human Sciences, a new $40 million facility slated to go into that complex. A new center for Carson Center for the Emerging Media Arts, new center that was able for us to begin, one of only two in the U.S., by Johnny Carson's foundation. Johnny was one of our most famous alums at the University of Nebraska, supported the university in a number of ways, including the $20 million gift recently to start this new Emerging Media Arts Center, new building being put in place for them. So a lot of momentum, if you will.
Yeah.
Innovation Campus on the former State Fairgrounds, now into its second phase of development, with a new building will open there this fall for public-private partnerships, over 30 different partnerships with private industry that we have on that campus now. And so just, you know, it's in my job, I get to sit there and think about how we're developing all of these things in a way that are going to better serve the needs of the people of Nebraska.